Sorry about that. No microphone. Okay. Dear members of the board, colleagues, students, parents, winners, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the summer ceremony of the University of Groningen. It's a bit hot, so the temperature in this aula will rise, I think. It's the official end of the academic season, and I especially welcome all our GUF 100 prize winners, the students and their families, the winners of the Wieringa Ringering University of Groningen Dissertation Prize, family members of Art Bosman, and our international students, of course. You're sitting at the back, hopefully. Yeah. This academic year has been a remarkable year for our university. I will not dwell upon it in a very extensive way, but we should not forget that this year one of our professors, Ben Veriga, won the 2016 Nobel Prize in Chemistry, and that's of course a remarkable effort. A short remark about today's program. We will start with the awarding ceremony of the GUF 100 prizes, the prizes for the best performing students in each faculty, and the presentation of the Art Bosman University of Groningen Excellence Award. That's the winner of all the winners of the faculties. And next we will have a musical intermezzo by some of our international students, and I will introduce them later on. And then we will have the presentation of the winners of the Wieringa Ringering Prize for the best dissertation defended in the year 2016. And after that, I will give the floor to the director of our Alumni Relations and Fundraising Office and Ubbo Emmius Foundation, Mr. Gerbrand Visser, who will introduce the foundation. And then we will install the international student ambassadors and ask one of the students to deliver a short speech. And lastly, after the ceremony, then we will end the ceremony and then we will ask the winners of the Wieringa Ringering Prize, the International Student Ambassadors and the GUF 100 prize winners to join me to take some photos on the stairs in front of the building. And after that, and that's the big reward, we will have the drinks and the barbecue. And that's where we're all looking forward to. So we will start with the awarding ceremony of the GUF 100 prize. Since 1983, the Groningen University Fund aims to promote studying at the University of Groningen. And I think I copy some of your text now, Lou. But I will give the floor to you in a minute to lead the ceremony from here. We are proud as a university that we can award these GUF 100 prizes. Please, Professor Lou de Ley, Chair of the Groningen Universiteitsfonds, the floor is yours.
Esteemed Rector Magnificus, dear colleagues, students and other attendees, it's my privilege as Chair of the Groningen University Foundation to announce the yearly GUF 100 prize winners during this ceremony. There are 10 GUF 100 prizes, each for the best student in a faculty. On top of that, there's one Art Bosman Excellence Award, which is given to the best of these prize winners, meaning the best student of this university this year. Before doing so, I will briefly give some explanation about the GUF 100 prizes, the Art Bosman Student Excellence Award, and especially pay some attention to the renewed procedure that was followed this year. This renewed procedure was developed by a team of four Honors Masters students: Marieke Zwaan, Anne-Lou Ubels, Kim Roete and Renske Wiersma, as part of their leadership lab assignment and in close cooperation with especially Dirk-Jan Wolfram from the GUF board. As always, when you are not relying on the good old routine but start something new, this takes lots of discussion, effort and also sometimes fuss. However, in hindsight, I can tell you that it is my sincere opinion that this was all worth it, and that we have a much more open and transparent competition, a better involvement of the students themselves, and importantly, that much more aspects of what makes a student the best were assessed this year. I'd like to thank our four honor master students who did a great job, but surely also all the students, staff and selection committees in the faculties for their efforts to make this new procedure a success. To go back to the GUF 100 prizes, the idea of the GUF 100 prizes was launched, as the rector already mentioned, on the 100th year anniversary of the Groningen University Foundation in 1993. That's why these are called the GUF, Groningen University Foundation, 100 prizes. The prices are €2,500 for each student to be used for academic study purposes. This year's procedure was as follows. In each faculty, a broad call for nominees was issued to third year bachelor and master students. And from these nominees, a faculty selection committee selected the best three students. Criteria were, first, proof of excellent study results, say at least within the top 20% of their peers. Second, and equally important, proof of outstanding personal and academic accomplishment that are beyond regular study activities. Also, other accomplishments in matters of university life, sports, music, and/or society can be taken into consideration. The three students who were selected were subsequently nominated by the faculty boards to the GUF board. And out of these three, the selection of GUF 100 prize winners was done during a special meeting in which all faculty nominees gave short pitches of 3 minutes about their field of study to show their quality and drive for excellence. A jury consisting of the members of the GUF board, supplemented with Daan van Dijk, who is a student member of the Presidium of the University, and Mark de Jager, student assessor with the board of the university, selected the prize winners, taking into account their CV, the motivation letter written either by themselves, a fellow student, or a member of staff of the or the faculty board, but last but not least, their presentation. It was a challenging but inspiring meeting, and I can tell you that the jury was greatly impressed by the quality and spirit of, in fact, all candidates. So the jury had a tough job, but in the end was quite unanimous in its choices. I will announce the winners in a moment, but before doing so, I must tell you that there was an additional, even tougher, round of selection to do, since the jury also had to choose who will be the most outstanding one of these 10 winners, to be awarded with an additional €2,500, or to be more precise, who will win the Art Bosman Student Excellence Award. Also, for your information, I can tell you that the Art Bosman Student Excellence Award is named after the late Professor Art Bosman. He was a professor at this university until 1995 and founder of the field of information systems in the Netherlands. The award has been made possible by our alumnus Gesines Hidding, who via the Ubbo Emmius Foundation is the main sponsor of this prize. The final part for this, of the selection for the Art Bosman Student Excellence Award was done this morning. All GUF 100 prize winners were invited to have a debate among each other on a number of pre-selected topics, both in a one-to-one confrontation and as part of a panel. And finally, they were invited to give a statement of 5 minutes about their view on the Art Bosman Student Excellence Award. The jury was the same as the one that selected the GUF 100 prizes and made a choice exactly 4 hours ago. I will announce the winner after the presentation of the GUF 100 prizes. So now I will give a short laudatio for all GUF 100 prize winners. Then the Rector Magnificus will give to the winners an envelope containing not the real money, but a letter with the instructions how to receive this 2,500 money. So maybe I give a short laudation, then the winner comes here, get his congratulations and the envelope. So. First, from the Faculty of Theology and Religious Studies, Bernice Brijan. Bernice, Bernice combined a number of studies. After a first year medicine, she restarted with two bachelors, one on Phrenuric and Hungarian languages and cultures in Groningen, and one on theology in Tilburg. In the meantime, she also did a first year of theology in Leiden, free studies. Both bachelor grades were awarded with cum laude. She really likes to do parallel things, since also now she's combining two masters, one in Tilburg on theology and one in Groningen on religion and culture. Her CV is packed with prizes, grants, academic visits abroad. She learned ancient and nowadays Hebrew, which is handy for her present work on the Dead Sea Scrolls, and she was active in archaeological digging in Jordan. She has been a student assistant a couple of times and obtained various research traineeships. In addition, she already has some interesting publication, followed the Master Honors Program on Leadership, and was active in a large number of committees. Last but not least, she is very interested and active in giving mental and spiritual care to patients. Congratulations. Second, from the Faculty of Philosophy, Joris Graaf. Also, Joris started with two studies, a bachelor in history and one in philosophy. After a propedeutic exam, he stopped with history and got a cum laude bachelor with a wave average score of 8.7 in philosophy. He is following the research master in philosophy now, where he combines neuroscience with philosophy. He did a stay abroad in the prestigious Philosophical Institute St. Andrews in Scotland and was a teaching assistant for a number of bachelor courses. In addition to that, he is very active in the Groningen Debating Society, Calliope, and interesting to note that he was nominated also by a fellow student who wrote, and I quote, "To conclude, I'm proud to be studying next to colleagues such as Joris, people who are self-aware, modest, and aiming to widen the scope of our knowledge. Such a recommendation helps, Joris. Congratulations." Third, from the Faculty of Arts, Annika Raschen. Annika is a student who also follows two bachelors, the first in International Relations and Organization and the second in European Languages and Cultures. She hasn't finished yet her bachelor's, but her current grades are very high, with an average of 8.9 for the first bachelor and 8.8 for the other. In addition, she has a very impressive list of additional activities, both on a university level, like for instance being an active student representative in the faculty board, and on a societal level, like for instance being a refugee coach at Humanitas. Despite these astonishing achievements, her supervisors coin her as contemplative, modest, and being a very nice person. Congratulations. Fourth, from the Faculty of Law, Edwin van de Velde. Also, Edwin hasn't completed his bachelor yet, but with a mean grade of 9.5, he is definitely heading for at least a cum laude. He is also active outside the study, where he is giving legal advices on location in the Groningen City District Helpman. He is doing also the honors bachelor program. He impressed the jury a lot during his pitch at the selection meeting. So the jury sees a lot of potentials. Congratulations. Finf, from the Faculty of Medical Sciences, Lisette van Os. Lisette is a student in the... Lisette is a student in the Top Master Program Medical Pharmaceutical Drug Innovation. She finished her Bachelor in Biology cum laude and did the Honors Bachelor Program. In addition, she followed a couple of summer schools abroad and has been selected to follow some more in the near future. She was awarded with a number of grants, and among one is the prestigious Pauline van Wachem Award. She is active in the Student Skating Society as well in the Honors College Social Associations. Congratulations. Sixth, from the Faculty of Behavioral and Social Sciences, Bertram Lot. Bertram is a student in the master program Educational Sciences and has an average grade of 8. Next to being a successful student, Bertram is also very much involved in a variety of organizations and committees that aim to improve education. During the academic year 2015-16, he was a member of the Nationale Denktank and wrote an advice on how to improve vocational education. I can tell you that he is very persuasive on that subject. It was clear for the jury during his pitch. He was a student member of the board of the department and education committee. Next, he contributed to the ESI program committee and the university education committee and several of its subcommittees. He is active in the culture scene in Groningen, and also for Bertram, it is interesting to note that in fact a fellow student was the one who nominated him for the prize. Congratulations. Seventh, from the Faculty of Economics and Business, Iris van der Heijden. Iris couldn't make it to be present here, so I will read her laudatio and, okay, she will see it on the movie. Iris has done two bachelors, one in international relations and organization at the Faculty of Humanities and one in international economics and business economics with the Faculty of Economics and Business. Now she has started a double degree master economics development and growth and is getting very high grades there. She is following the honors master's program on leadership and is also internationally very active. She helped to set up that mission program for the University College Groningen and was a student representative in the Board of Education of this faculty. She has a student teaching assistantship at the Careers Company, was counselor of the ISAC Summer School in Japan, facilitator of the United World College short course in Israel, and managed the social media of a startup NGO for child and youth finances. A lot. She has more honors and achievements, but in view of the time, I will stop here. And although she couldn't make it to be present today, I still like to say congratulations. Eighth, from the Faculty of Spatial Sciences, Antje Bieberstein. Antje did a Bachelor East Asian Studies with a focus on Japan and psychology at the University of Hamburg, Germany. Part of that was a semester at the Doshisha University in Kyoto, Japan. Then she moved to Groningen to start a double degree master social demography and population studies between the University of Groningen and the Universitat Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona. Throughout all her studies, she got exceptionally high grades. She is active in the evaluation committee of the study, is a student assistant, and she does the honors master program on leadership. Her supervisor was especially positive about the way she stimulates international students to mix with their Dutch fellow students. Congratulations. Ninth, from the Faculty of Science and Engineering, Volkert Norberts. Volkert has done two bachelors, one in physics and one in astronomy, and graduated with a cum laude from both. In addition, he did the Bachelor Honors program. Now he's doing two master programs, again one in physics and one in astronomy, and now he is getting even higher grades, which in the end may lead to two summa cum laudes. We will see. Very, very high grades, I can tell you. His findings will lead to a publication in a major scientific journal, as he proudly announced today. He started an international association for students in astronomy, and in addition, he is very keen at reaching out to the public to tell about the marvelous findings modern astronomy has to offer. So he is a volunteer at the Blauw Observatory and at the Jongere Werkgroep Sterrenkunde. Congratulations. Tenth, and this is the first time from this faculty, is the University Campus Groningen. Jackie Wang. Jackie is pursuing a Bachelor in Physics of Energy, was part of an exchange program with the McGill University in Canada, and gets high grades in his study. In addition, he is doing the honors program and is a teaching assistant for first year students. Concerning the latter, he put a quote in his motivation letter that I like to repeat for you, namely, when one teaches, two learn. This is, I guess, a very wise statement for a young student. Applies to the whole university, that's the idea. He's doing a number of extracurricular activities from which one is particularly interesting to mention, namely, being a student assistant consultant in the team that was active in the preparation of the Rug branch campus Yantai. Being a native Mandarin speaker, he was quite instrumental in, among others, explaining the Chinese culture and educational system to the Rug team. Jackie will be a speaker also later this day, namely as one of the alumni ambassadors. So yes, that was also one of his activities. Congratulations. Now that we know all 10 GUF 100 prize winners, it's time to come to the final decision of who is the best of the best, or phrased otherwise, who will win the prestigious Aart Bosman Excellence Award. This year, the jury had a tough decision to make after hearing the debates between the candidates this morning on a number of pre-selected topics. After listening to the opinion of these excellent students in a panel debate on what's excellence is within a university and seeing them again in a 5-minute pitch about their motivation to be a student at this university and striving to excel. We were impressed as a jury by their honesty, modesty, and their views. We learned that, in their view, excellence is not an individual prerogative, but what we share together, used to inspire each other, and by doing so, where disciplines meet and challenge each other, new knowledge can emerge and flourish. That's exactly what our university also wants to do. After this inspiring event, the jury still had to do a job, and in the end, we were selected. We selected primarily because of his great passion for research, but also for his excellent results, his willingness to share his enthusiasm, and to pass this to the next generation as the year 2070 winner of the Art Bosman Excellence Award, Volkert Nobel. Congratulations.
Thank you all for being here. I'm really honored with receiving this award. During this day, someone mentioned that we could do a project with all the Gov100 prize winners to make the world a better place. If this opportunity like this rises, I will accept this with both hands. This weekend, I will go to Dwingelo to talk to the volunteers that inspired me when I was a small child. It is nice to see that the spark in their eyes when they talk about astronomy is still present. I hope that in the following decade, there are people like me, inspired by me.
Yes, nice. Congratulations to all winners. And this morning we had a breakfast with some of you. Six of you could be present, and we talked about where you're from. And Volkert is from, I should explain that maybe. You're basically from the Bijlen region. So as a child, indeed, you saw the people working at Astron, and that gave you the inspiration to go into the programs of physics and astronomy. Again, congratulations. It's now time for some music, so I'm happy to introduce you to Triune, consisting of three international students, an Irish singer, a Greek pianist, and a Spanish guitarist. So let me introduce the three, and then two of them will play at the first intermezzo. First is Erica Duffy, student international and European law, and you will sing. And then we have Nicole Garalambos. Ah, there you are. You're on the piano. International Communications and Media. And then we have Alvaro Garcia, international and European law as well, on guitar. And you wait for a minute, I think. Yeah. So I will give the floor to Erika and Nicole, who will start. Please, the floor is yours.
Flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me. Ooh. And I'm feeling fish in the sea, you know how I feel. River running free, you know how I feel. Blossom on a tree, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me, and I'm feeling good. Dragonfly out in the sun, you know what I mean. Butterflies all having fun, you know what I mean. Sleep in peace when day is done, that is what I mean. And this old world is a new world and a bold world for me. Stars, when you shine, you know how I feel. Scent of the pine, you know how I feel. Oh, freedom is mine, and that is how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me, and I'm feeling
good. So the next item on our program is the award of the Wieringa Ringering 2016 prize for the best dissertation. University of Groningen is happy to award this prize for the best dissertation defended in 2016, and we will do that for the third time here at this ceremony. The prize consists of a substantial financial support. You can see the amount here on my, for your left hand side, to be spent on academic development, as we say it broadly. So at the request of the Rector Magnificus, the deans of the faculties have been invited to submit candidate winning dissertations and a short motivation. All nominated dissertations have been awarded with the verdict cum laude. And a jury consisting of former rectors Bleuming, Boscher, Schwartz and myself has evaluated the four nominations in the end. And I list the nominations in alphabetical order of the last names of the candidates. And the first one is by Jordi van Gestel, and the title of the dissertation is The Evolution of Bacterial Cell Differentiation and Multicellular Organization. And he was a student at the Faculty of Science and Engineering. Second one is by Rutger Gjaltema, and the title of the dissertation is Modifications of Collagen and Chromatin in ECM-related disease, Uncovering Therapeutic Targets for Fibrosis and Cancer at the Faculty of Medical Sciences. Third is Evert de Haan, and the title of the dissertation is Creating, Managing and Monitoring Customer Value in the On and Offline World. And this thesis was defended at the Faculty of Economics and Business. And number four is by Nigel Hamilton, and the title of the dissertation is Commander-in-Chief FDR's Battle with Churchill, 1943. And Dr. Hamilton graduated from the Faculty of Arts. So it goes without saying that all dissertations are of exceptional quality, and I congratulate all four nominated candidates with their nomination. So please give them a hand. This year, the jury has decided to award the Wieringa Ringering Prize for the best dissertation to to two winners. So basically you could say that the jury did a lousy job, but we could not decide on a single winner. And only a single winner would get 7,500 euro. But we added some money from another fund, the Nicolaas Meliers Foundation, was so kind to allow us to top it up to 5,000 euro each to both winners. So let me explain who the winners are. And I'm very happy that both winners can be here today, despite living in Switzerland and the US. So they took some effort to be here. Well, thank you for that. So allow me to introduce each winner by reading some lines of the jury report. And the first winner is Dr. Jordi van Gestel. Maybe you can come to the fore so we can see your tall. So you're from the Faculty of Science and Engineering, and the title of your dissertation was, let me repeat it, The Evolution of Bacterial Cell Differentiation and Multicellular Organization. In his dissertation, van Gestel shows that bacterial populations are not simple, but highly structured. Bacterial cells are even able to gamble and spread risks. I didn't know that, but yeah. Van Gestel uses mathematical models to describe these complex interactions and dynamics of bacterial populations. And let me not dive into all the details of the dissertation, but let me share some of the observations that the jury made with you. The first one is that 7 out of the 8 chapters have been published, all of them with Jordi van Gestel as a first author. One article is in PLOS Biology, and it was highlighted as a cover story in Science, while another of your articles was highlighted in Nature. Secondly, van Gestel has completed his work within 4 years, which is a remarkable achievement. Let me share that by experience. The project was financed through grant applications, also written by Dr. van Gestel himself. Thirdly, 5 chapters were not co-authored by his thesis advisor, Franjo Wijsing, who we should give some honor, I think, but not writing with you is also an honor, but by self-selected collaborators at the universities of Harvard, Princeton, and Jena. And lastly, Jordi van Gestel is also able to communicate over his work. He presented his work at a TEDx meeting and was active in the very nice event that we had with Studium Generale some time ago with the famous Richard Dawkins. So we're more than happy to award you with the prize, the Wengering-Rienger Prize for Best Dissertation defended in 2016. And may I invite you to collect the prize, and we will give it in a symbolic way like this, and then we make a photo. So I'm very happy to give the floor now to Dr. Jordi van Gestel to share some of his ideas with us. Please.
I have used it.
I'm even tall here, I guess. Thank you all for coming, and I want to thank the committee for awarding my thesis with this beautiful prize. I'm actually amazed that among all the dissertations that are published or made last year, mine, together with Mr. Hamilton, Dr. Hamilton, have been awarded with this prize. So when I was notified that I was going to receive this prize, I immediately had to think back of a prize that I won at high school. So my father plays in an orchestra, and every year they organize a concert. And during the break of this concert, they have a small lottery. So as a 15-year-old kid, I decided to join. I bought some tickets, and to my surprise, I won the first prize, which was a food basket of the local supermarket, which was filled with food items close or over the expiration date. So there is some improvement, you could say. But despite these half-molded food items, I felt very happy. I felt I did the effort of buying this ticket, everybody had the same odds of winning the prize, so I deserved it. For this prize, on the contrary, I'm indebted to many people. I had the privilege of working in many groups, and many people helped me, without whom I couldn't have written this dissertation. So I want to use a minute to thank those people. First, I would like to thank the Molecular Genetics Lab in Groningen, headed by Professor Oscar Kuipers, and his postdoc that helped me out, Akos Kovacs. So they took up the challenge of learning how to do lab work. In my master's, I didn't do any laboratory experiments. I was a theoretical biologist. And I went to them and said, like, well, I would like to do some lab work. And they said, well, why not? So they learned me how to pipe it. They learned me how to do the things in the lab. And what I especially remember was the very enjoyable conversations with Oscar, because he was always very excited about other people's work, even potentially boring work of a theoretical biologist like me. So thank you, Oscar. A second group that I worked in was the program of evolution dynamics at Harvard University. And there I would also like to thank two people in particular, Professor Martin Novak and Dr. Corina Tarnita. So she's now currently in Princeton. So Martin Novak is a very exceptionally talented scientist that published many papers in Nature and Science, more than I have fingers and toes. But still, when I met him, he was excited like a first year biology student. And I found it very striking, and this was very infectious to me. Corina Tarnita was my day-to-day supervisor there, and she had a very like-minded scientific spirit, so we collaborated very intensely, and still we're collaborating until this day. We almost came there. So the third group I would like to thank is the Coulter Lab at Harvard Medical School. And there also I would like to thank two people in particular, Roberta Coulter and Hira Vlamakis. So Hira Vlamakis was there, the postdoc supervisor that also gave me day-to-day supervision. And Roberta Coulter was a professor. And he was quite one of a kind. He was one of the most inspiring persons I met. And he was not only a great scientist, but especially a quite fascinating group leader. We had many wine tastings, many great dinners, an amazing lab retreat in which everybody got the time of 3 hours to talk to the group. And then finally, I would like to thank my home base, the University of Groningen, and particularly the theoretical biology group in Groningen, and my supervisor, PhD supervisor, Franjo Weising. So Franjo, I got to know him in my first year of the bachelor program, and he gave the course Mathematical Biology. So he was very intensely involved with the students, and that's when I got really excited for science. At that moment, I decided I want to do science. And since then, he's been mentoring me over the years, shaping me as a scientist, but also exposing me to different kinds of science. And he very much stimulated me to go abroad and to interact with different groups. So I want to thank him for the freedom he gave me to design the PhD that I wanted and for giving me this opportunity. Finally, I want to thank you and the family supporting this prize. I tell you, I'm going to do some interesting science with it. Thank you very much.
So congratulations, Jordi van Gestel. And now we go to the second winner, Dr. Nigel Hamilton. Maybe you can come to the fore, we can see you. Yeah. And the title of Dr. Hamilton's dissertation is Commander-in-Chief, FDR's Battle with Churchill 1943. So Dr. Hamilton has been so kind to attend this ceremony, coming all the way from Boston, I think, US. So thank you very much for doing that. You're kind of an exceptional winner, I think, today. So I would like to invite you in a minute to share some of your thoughts with us. Dr. Hamilton's dissertation, let me explain that, is a biography of Franklin Delano Roosevelt and focuses on the important year 1943. And I should explain that Dr. Hamilton is an experienced biographer, having published about the lives of US presidents and more. But in Commander-in-Chief, he illuminates the essential battle between Churchill and Roosevelt on the strategy how to beat Nazi Germany. If I'm wrong, you should correct me in a minute. And Dr. Hamilton uses new documents, like personal notes, to partly rewrite history and to bring the writing of a biography into academic research. An important element is the use of the idea of a turning point in a person's life, explaining an essential change of behavior over time in making decisions. So the dissertation is extremely well written and truly innovative in various respects. And it's a wonderful combination of meticulous research and a very personal narrative that reaches out to the reader. Let me explain that Dr. Hamilton's dissertation has attracted a lot of attention in the media, not only in the US, but also in Europe. And given the time frame of current politics in the two continents, let me be kind of, you know, try to be objective. And thinking about Hamburg and the G20 and somebody who was present there, we are extremely happy that you, Dr. Hamilton, are willing to deliver a short acceptance speech for our academic community about the issues that you would like to raise. And I think we find today's occasion the best possible audience to accept your speech here. So may I invite you, after receiving the prize, to say a few words to us.
Sure.
Congratulations.
Thank you, Rector. Thank you, everybody who came here today. Thank you to the Via Ringering family for sponsoring this prize. I should say that it is rather wonderful to be winning a PhD dissertation prize at my advanced age, 73, and I should explain that I failed to win a prize a bit like this 52 years ago this summer. I was a young graduate at Cambridge University in England, and I had planned to do a PhD on German history, and I failed. So winning this prize over half a century later is very touching, and I'm most grateful. I'm very grateful also to my wife, who was a word I'd never knew before, my paranymph at my defense here in this very room during a very difficult interrogation, appearing somewhat like as in front of the Supreme Court. I can see a number of the esteemed opponenti here today. But I'd also like to thank very much my two advisors, Dr. Hans Renders, wherever he is, the director of the Biography Institute. And it's really through Dr. Renders that I came to do my dissertation here at Groningen, because here at this university you have really the only major institute of biography, certainly at a major university in Europe, and actually probably in the world. Rather than doing it at Cambridge, I am proud to have done my PhD here at Groningen through the auspices and help with the help of the Biography Institute, part of the also the Faculty of History here at Groningen. And also to your former provost, Dr. Duco Boscia, a great Americanist, who corrected many of my mistakes, including at times my English. So thank you all, and I have come a long way. My dissertation was in three parts, two parts to do with the theory of biography, biography as a corrective of many of the mistakes that historians make. Also, the nature of the biographical process, the process that a biographer goes through in coming to an understanding of a real life. But the major part of my thesis was a study of Franklin Delano Roosevelt in World War II. And if it isn't arrogant to say, I definitely intend to change history, if history is what we understand by the past, looking at the past. I hope to change that, at least our appreciation of Franklin Delano Roosevelt. So I wanted to take a few minutes to talk about the relationship between the 32nd President of the United States and the 45th President of the United States. The term world order is one we've seen quoted a great deal recently. World order is difficult to define satisfactorily, for it covers a multitude of sins depending on where you're situated or where you see yourself in that order. In general, though, it refers to the international order that emerged from the ravages of World War II and the rough but amazingly resilient security structure that has ensured relative world peace for the past 72 years. World peace, that is to say, in the sense that we haven't suffered a third world war, or seen local or regional conflicts spiral completely out of control as they did in the First World War in 1914, and again in the Second World War in 1939 and 1941. It's a world order, however, that many observers feel is gravely threatened by the election and maverick performance of the 45th US President, Donald J. Trump. Now, scores of analysts and political writers in America have adduced literally hundreds of reasons why the nation should be anxious about Mr. Trump today. I don't suppose I can add much to those analytics. As a transplanted European who is now a US citizen, I see a wildly swerving, oddball partnership between a maverick president and a Republican Party which never seriously thought he could win election to the US presidency and is now tied to his deliberately destabilizing agenda. A partnership that at home affects rafts of issues, from healthcare to the environment, from education to the social contract, from immigration to the freedom of the press, and which abroad rattles allies who have for decades trusted the word of the United States, pulling away from its own creation, NATO, appeasing Russia in its electoral cyber tactics as well as its military predations, abandoning international free trade agreements, threats to go solo into action against North Korea, unilateral strikes in the Middle East. These are not the actions of a reliable leader of the world's democracies within a stable world order, but the behavior of a rogue state. It is this international dimension that most concerns me as a citizen and most interests me as a historian. For whatever Trump may Twitter about fake news, and however much he may trumpet alternative facts, it's more important than ever that historians should continue to use their training to provide a reliable historical framework for those seeking to make sense of the world we live in and work in. Is it Trump? Or is there a structural reason for the current political earthquake that has destabilized America? Certainly, there are those in academia who see in the current instability a vast and inevitable shift in the world economy away from the West, one that was bound eventually to affect capital markets and declining incomes in the West in such a way that different segments of Western society would inexorably, blindly, angrily react and turn against each other. Dog eat dog. In this diagnosis, the relative economic decline of the West was and is fated to produce internecine conflict at home, as most people feel financially pressured and struggle with one another over a relatively smaller size of the economic cake. This soon descends into a cultural and political blame game, pointing at others, be they immigrants competing for scarcer resources or international conglomerates operating with ruthless disregard of local consequences, or just the sheer selfishness and greed of the 1%, the very rich. Inevitably, in this diagnosis, such divisions simply spread like a tsunami beyond the shores of home and threaten the world order that has guaranteed relative peace and stability for a lifetime. This structural explanation is quite compelling. To put it simply, as the globe tilts ever further away from the West and towards the vaster populations of Asia, as the dominant economic area of investment, production, and commerce, it's perhaps inevitable there will be increasing levels of domestic, social, and political conflict in the West as people in Europe and America adjust or fail to adjust to their relative economic decline and diminishing expectations of ever higher standards of living compared with the rest of the world. That saga, which we witness in mounting arguments over immigration, inequality, health, regulations, and education, will continue for years to come. The question is, though, how will it affect the peace and stability of nations as they deal with each other? Whether in the South China Sea, or in Syria, or the Ukraine, or North Korea. How, in other words, will the world order be affected? And it's here that, as a biographer and historian of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the 32nd US president, I would like briefly to look at the creation of the world order 72 years ago. How exactly it came to be, what FDR envisioned, and what chances of success in reality he gave to his own creation in the real world. 75 years ago, in 1942, President Roosevelt, who often called himself an obstinate old Dutchman, wrote to another obstinate leader of Dutch descent, Prime Minister Jan Christian Smuts of South Africa, saying, "As you know, I dream dreams, but am at the same time an intensely practical person." FDR's dream was to establish a post-war world organization out of the coalition of nations that he had christened the United Nations earlier that year. The 26 countries fighting the Axis powers of Nazi Germany, Japan, and their satellites. He had already set down in writing the aims and objectives of those countries opposing fascism and conquest by military force, namely the now famous Atlantic Charter, which he'd signed with Winston Churchill in the summer of 1941. 4 months later, he created the United Nations, a name he announced to the astonished British Prime Minister who was staying at his guest at the White House and who was naked in his bath when the US President rushed in his wheelchair to tell him of it. Those 26 nations, the United Nations, promised under his aegis in Washington to commit themselves to the principles of the Atlantic Charter, not only during the war, but once the war was won. Throughout 1942, FDR worked to develop the idea of an international organization based on the success of his United Nations coalition. It was to be, he envisaged, an organization that would invite representatives from all sovereign nations, but one that, in its dealings, would avoid the pitfalls of the earlier League of Nations, which neither the United States nor Russia had ever joined after World War I, and which collapsed in 1939. He thus developed, with his Assistant Secretary of State, Sumner Wells, the notion of a UN Security Council, working on behalf of the main UN organization to address threats to world peace and security. Moreover, to provide teeth to this Security Council, he advanced the notion that the four most powerful countries of the world, the United States, Britain, the USSR, and China, yes, China, in 1942, would act as the four policemen on the UN's behalf, cauterizing and, if necessary, interceding if disputes between countries grew out of hand. This, in 1942, was the origin of the UN as we know it. And it was while drafting his intended speech to be given at the inaugural meeting of the UN in April 1945 that President Roosevelt suddenly complained of a terrible headache and died of a cerebral hemorrhage at his desk only 3 weeks before the unconditional surrender of Hitler's thousand-year Third Reich. Now, we can all debate the effectiveness and ineffectiveness over the subsequent years of the United Nations in terms of world security, i.e. outside of its extraordinary work on global health, economic assistance, refugees, food, emergency aid, the environment. But when devising the United Nations, FDR himself worried that the European empires would, after the war, avoid giving self-government and sovereignty to their colonial territories, including the Netherlands. He worried that the Soviet Union's international intentions, especially in terms of democracy, were untrustworthy. Russia. And that China, though destined by its geography, population, and history to be a great world power again, could temporarily be hobbled by civil war. As he put it to a journalist, Walter Lippmann, after the first big international meeting of foreign ministers in Moscow in 1943, quote, "Sometimes I feel that the world will be mighty lucky if it gets 50% of what it seeks out of the war as a permanent success." Well, Franklin Roosevelt, the obstinate old Dutchman, was an idealistic realist or a realistic idealist. How he nevertheless managed, in the midst of a world war in which he was the directing military mind as well as political leader, to conceive and develop the UN as the basis for post-war international progress and security is surely one of the most extraordinary stories of the 20th century. However disappointing the UN has proved in specific instances and circumstances over the past seven decades, it has provided both a forum and a structure that has helped to avoid world war, in contrast to the League of Nations, and to avert regional conflagrations from getting out of hand. Two of FDR's four policemen, the US and the USSR, dueled in a Cold War, but they did not fight. The third policeman, Britain, spent years coming to terms with decolonization. And the fourth, China, spent decades immune to international matters, for the most part, before claiming its inevitable seat at the world's top table of economic and military affairs. The new world order, in other words, followed a rocky path, but it survived. I am almost done. Today, however, we see ourselves faced with the possible demise of FDR's original construct. Whether Donald Trump should be seen as the spoiler of a system whose history he does not know, or merely as its ignorant victim, is up to you. What is clear to those of us who value history is that the world order was no accidental or even inevitable creation. In the midst of the most violent war in human history, it was devised by a great world leader, a man who saw himself as a kind of shepherd. He had guided his nation out of the Great Depression without the country turning to fascism or tyranny, and he then led it from deep isolationism to world military leadership in confronting and defeating the Axis powers of Germany and Japan. He did not intend the United States to become a sole superpower in the post-war era. Rather, he saw it as but one of the world's four policemen working with and on behalf of the United Nations, ensuring a stable world order. As the United States slips back into isolationism and relative economic decline, President Trump's mantra of making America great again rings very hollow. Wiser by far, I think, to hang on to our seats and look elsewhere, even to Beijing, rather than to Washington, for a wise patriarch who, like FDR, will hopefully step forward to guide us through the coming rapids. Thank you.
So thank you, Dr. Hamilton, and again, Dr. Van Gestel and Dr. Hamilton, congratulations. So now we have time for a second musical intermezzo. And this round we will listen to Alvaro on guitar and Nicole again, I think. Or, oh yeah, there we are. Yeah. Okay, the floor is yours.
Thank you.
So, thank you very much. We now come to the part for our international students. Welcome here. And it's my pleasure to give the floor to Mr. Gerbrand Visser, director of our Alumni Relations and Fundraising Office and the Hugo Emmius Foundation, to lead the meeting from here. Gerbrand.
When you say goodbye, we say hello. Dear all, my name is Gerbrand Visser. I am heading the Alumni Relations Office of this university, and I'm also the director of the Emmius Fund, and that's the university's charity fund, and that was established about 20 years ago with the aim to raise additional funding for students and scientists and for the unique University of Groningen research projects. The president of the Urban Emmius Fund is Paul Polman, also known as Chief Executive Officer of Unilever, and he is a graduate of our university. He left the Netherlands about in 77, and he is always trying to speak Dutch, but his English is much better nowadays. Needless to say, the university is extremely happy to have him on the board of the Urban Emmius Fund, in the same way that Paul Polman was happy to accept his task for the university. In general, we find that many alumni, whether in the Netherlands or elsewhere in the world, have a strong Groningen feeling. Many of them, and many of us here, have a soft spot for the university and for the city of Groningen. We all have been inspired by specific professors and specific courses. And I'm sure that many of us can indicate the precise moments that shaped our careers. We all share memories of studying at the library, of handing in exams and presenting papers, and of cycling, walking, or even running through the city at all hours. Dear students, you are about to leave this university. Very soon, you will no longer be student, but alumnus or alumna, and the University of Groningen will be your alma mater. We consider you as our ambassadors, for you truly know what a Groningen education really means. We very much want to stay in touch with you in various ways, through newsletters, alumni events, and through our alumni networks all over the world, London, Hong Kong, New York, Jakarta, to mention some. We invite you to visit our alumni events, share your knowledge, support one another, and if possible, future generations of students and alumni. Meet Groningen alumni, if only for the gezelligheid. Keep in touch and let us know how you are doing and what the university can do for you, and of course, what you can do for the university. On our website, you can sign up for our worldwide newsletter and our social media communities. Should our researchers be traveling your way, they may very well be willing to offer a lecture, wherever it is. And there is more. The prizes that were just handed out to our best student and to our PhD students of the year are examples of alumni support. Alumnus Gesine's Hidding is the sponsor of the Aart Bosman Student Excellence Award. And the family Wienga Rengerink has also been so kind to sponsor our best PhD students. It's now two students, normally it's one. And the family Wienga Rengerink is also present at this event. More in general, the University of Groningen alumni are making it possible for students from developing countries to study and live in Groningen. Our networks of alumni, called alumni chapters, support research projects that need extra funding. And also, alumni in Singapore, for example, are creating internship opportunities for students. In fact, the list of examples of alumni involvement is much longer. In conclusion, we are tremendously grateful for the support we receive from our alumni. This is why today we would like to honor our new group of international alumni ambassadors. They volunteered to help us to promote the university all over the world, and they will undoubtedly do an excellent job. And our Rector Magnificus, Professor Elmer Sterke, will do us the honor of thanking you in person on behalf of the University of Groningen community. And Professor Sterke will also hand out the certificates from which it appears that they are the alumni ambassadors for the coming year.
So first of all, could the international students present here maybe stand on their feet? Then we can see you. Okay, great. Thank you. So, yeah. So what we will do now is ask you to come over and we will hand you a certificate. So I will call your name and your home country. So let us start with Eva Amon from Germany. Are you here? Yeah, here you are. Oh yeah. Do that this way. Yeah. Congratulations. Thank you. Then we go to Kwaku Anana Sarpong from Ghana. Please. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Okay. Then we move on to Anton Fuschstetter from Germany. Then we have Paulina Julia Perkal from Poland. Please, yes, and thank you. Congratulations. Then we have Wael Talbi from Saudi Arabia. Ah, there you are. Yeah. David Peng from China. I use your American name. Victoria Titrol from the US. Ah. Please, yeah, thank you. Okay. Nina Maria Siepke from Germany. Thank you. Yeah, we have a certificate for you. Yeah, please. Dwani Srivastava from India. Oleg Tortlatse from Georgia. Please, yeah, thank you. Jackie Wang from China. There you are again. Lastly, Kuyan Zhang. Ah, there you are. From China. Thank you. And congratulations to you all. And to close this part of the ceremony, I would like to ask Jackie Wang to say a few words to us. Please.
Well, that's the fun part begins. I know probably half of the audience might thinking like, why this guy again? I promise you, I noticed that barbecue is on the way, so. So I come on the stage for three times. So I'm my story gonna start with number three. 3 years ago, I come to University of Groningen. During the flight, I was so excited about everything I was about to see, from windmill to cheese market, being overwhelmed with bikes, to being towered over by tall people like you guys. I arrived at the Schiphol airport around 8 in the evening and took a train back to Groningen. Everything seems so unfamiliar. The signs, clothes, weather, and even the gorgeous people like you guys. Inside of my heart, I could feel a sense of excitement and mixed with a sense of a bit nervousness. I thought my wonderful and crazy Dutch journey is about to begin. But the gods sometimes send nuts to those who have no teeth. By that, I mean, nothing comes out as planned. Late that night, I was on the train heading north. Then two men took my bag and quickly ran off the train seconds ago before the train door closed. My passport, money, and many important documents were gone. I tried to shout for help, but there was no one around me. Standing in the train by myself, feeling alone and helpless. All the excitement I had before vanished and went up in smoke. And I thought, why I choose to come to this place? Luckily, I still have my phone with me. I had no choice but called the admission officer of my faculty, Charlotte, who is also present here today. After 2 hour ride, I arrived at the central station here in Groningen. Just a second I got off the train, I saw a woman standing there waving at me. I can be easily recognized. I'm very popular here. Within her hands, she had a bottle of water and a piece of cheese sandwich, so Dutch. She quickly ran to me and gave me a big hug. After all the exhausting ordeals I have been through that night, that is what I really need. Charlotte took me to the police office and stayed there through the entire process of investigations. By that time I left, it was 2 in the morning, and I was ready to call it a day. When I arrived at my accommodation, I had expected everyone to be in bed. Not my bed, but their bed. However, to my huge surprise, I met my housemate that night. And in fact, they are waiting for me until 2 in the morning. The hugs, greetings, and stories followed by helping a hand to unpack. This welcome really deeply impacted me. A flower could not help me but bloom inside of my heart. I felt home, and I found my home here in Groningen. My favorite place in Groningen is the Martini Tower. Every time I look from the top of the Martini Tower, I see the skyline of the city and the people working around in the Houtmarkt. Atop that tower, I had a sense of pride, a sense of accomplishment. This is the city where I live now, and this is the city where I call it home. My study life here in Groningen has not only broadened my horizon, knowing that the sushi in Japan tastes different, Latin American loves hugging, kissing, and dancing. Dutch people don't drink beers all day, although they do drink beers most of the time. And most importantly, I also represent my country. Chinese people are not always good at math. But in fact, I am, I have to admit. I'm not really good, but anyway. My study life also allows me to grow and become a better version of myself. Allows me to join the climbing association to defeat of my fear of height. It also allows me to join student politics campaign and also the Honors College philosophy program that allows me to touch upon the topic of Western democracy that I have never had that before. It also allows me to talk and debate with full confidence. And here I am, standing in front of you. So, who made those changes? The Groningen itself? No, the city may not have the magic, but it is the people. It is you guys, my fellow students, professors, and even the alumni. It is you, and also the citizens, by the way. It is you that make this place feels like a home. So, dear professors, students, and alumni, I have a question here to all of you. How are you going to describe Groningen? And how are you going to describe University of Groningen? Inspiring, happy, or international? Or even, there's more bars than the days of the year. Or thousands of associations that you can sign up for? or even waiting for getting to the physics building while noticing the Nobel Prize winner is just behind you. I really want to take a selfie. Have no chance. Unfortunately. Indeed, there are many things can describe Groningen. All the things I mentioned above are true, but from many to one, I will say home. Groningen is my home, and I believe it is also you guys' home, your home. That's almost done, so clapping. During the opening ceremony of the academic year, like 3 years ago, I remember Professor Popoma actually asked every international student to try to pronounce Groningen in a very Dutch way. Now, Ms. Popoma, here's the time to test my Dutch. I will say a sentence. I tried this, I prepared this many times. Here we go. Ich hab nichts boven Groningen. Popoma, hoot? Cool. There's nothing above Groningen, because there's nothing above your home. Thank you.
So thank you, Jackie, for a wonderful speech. And congratulations being our student alumni ambassador. So we come to the end of the summer ceremony. I invite all our winners and international ambassadors to join me to go to the stairs to take some group pictures. The others I invite for drinks downstairs. So follow the beetle in the cafeteria. And I should announce that the special vegetarian dishes are also served. I wish you all a very pleasant summertime and productive summertime if necessary. And thank you for your presence and attention. And I close the ceremony. So.